Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Pastor Ray Greenlee from the National Prayer Chapel. We're here to talk about Jesus. Is that the desire of your heart? To talk about, to know, and to follow Jesus Christ? If so, you're welcome. I invite you to call and share on this broadcast with us what Jesus is doing in your life, how you are experiencing him, or if you are not, if you are far away from Jesus and you need to make a change in your life, you're welcome to call. We'll talk about it. We'll pray about it together. Our phone number is 877-534-0780. Again, that number, 877-534-0780. We're talking about this book by Norman Grubb entitled Rees Howell's Intercessor. It opens for us the way to God. It opens for us the ways of God. We were just sharing in the chapter last time we spoke together about after Rees had received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, after he had submitted his life to Jesus, about 3 years later, during this wonderful Welsh revival, he began to have a real hunger in his heart for more. Now, John Wesley speaks about this in terms of the second touch. The second touch, where the Holy Spirit comes and he deals with the very nature of a man and he eradicates that old nature. He doesn't just suppress it. The scriptures say destroys. This is where not sin per se is dealt with, but the character, the very nature of a man is dealt with. And he's cleansed and he's purified. There is a much higher place that you and I are called to. We have lived in a very cheap, casual, shallow Christian culture. We're being called out of that culture and into something much more significant, a much different walk before the Lord. Many of you have spent almost no time seeking the Lord. You might read your scriptures in the morning. You might even say a prayer in the car on the way to work. You might even shoot prayers at heaven through the day, but you have not really dealt with the character issues of your life. And so you know how to walk in the world and be successful in the world, and then you know how to go to church and be respected and loved and looked up to in the church. That's not the kind of walk I'm talking about. I'm talking about a walk with Jesus where you have intimate communion with him 24/7, where the whole desire of your heart and your life is to be given over fully into the hand and the heart of Jesus. Now, there are some who are on one side very caught up in their religion, whether it be Catholic or Presbyterian or Baptist, very caught in their denominational structures and rituals. They're very caught in the church calendar. They like the rhythm of the Christian life based on the Christian calendar. They like to celebrate the special events and the holidays, and this marks out their life. But it's also obvious that they are full of sin and darkness. And yet they say, I'm saved. Well, no, they're not. Salvation does not come by ritual. Salvation does not come by denominational affiliation. Salvation does not come by religion. Salvation comes by dying, by being crucified, by giving up the creation of my own life, and totally giving myself over for the Holy Spirit to create what He chooses, to use me as He chooses for other people. It is a life of total self-sacrifice and giving and submission. Not just submission to Jesus, but submission to others. A humility. Not bragging, not a strong, independent spirit that says, I'll do it my own way. No, we're preparing for heaven. Heaven is not going to be that kind of place. Heaven is in every sense a community under the rulership of a king. When you look at the relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, what is most striking to me is that they constantly prefer one another above themselves. The Holy Spirit constantly prefers Jesus to Himself. He's not here in the world to make a name for Himself. He's here to lift up the crucified and resurrected Jesus Christ. He's here that we might know Him, the author and the finisher of our salvation. There's an unselfishness. That's how God is calling us to live. And I'm going to reread a part of what I shared yesterday because you need the context to understand the depth of what's being said. The Holy Spirit comes to Rees and offers him an incredible gift, the gift of being lifted up and seated in heavenly places with Christ, as it describes in the book of Ephesians. After that offer was made, it took 5 days to make the decision, days which were spent alone with God. Like Isaiah, I saw the holiness of God, and seeing him, I saw my own corrupt nature. It wasn't sins that I saw, but nature touched by the fall. I was corrupt to the core. I knew I had to be cleansed. I saw there was as much difference between the Holy Spirit and myself as between light and darkness. Nothing is more real to me than the process I went through for that whole next week. The Holy Spirit went on dealing with me, exposing the root of my nature, which was self. I spoke with a dear sister this morning who has been in a most painful situation. She lost her spouse. She's been without a home. She's been living with friends and then moving to another friend's. She's been going through a time not knowing where her next meal will come from, some days not eating. She's been having a very, very difficult time. And she's been wondering and asking God and complaining to God about, why is God treating me this way? And why is it taking so long? I mean, I'm a broken person. When will you rescue me, God? I know others who have gone through similar things, and I certainly am still going through much of that. At the heart of it is that Jesus is trying to deal with self. Self-protection, self-esteem. He's trying to deal with the inner part of a man or woman who with pride takes a stand. If you haven't become yet acquainted with what I'm speaking of, you need to spend some time in the prayer closet beseeching God to show you yourself. That self nature, that wolf nature, if I could be more bold, the serpent nature, that nature that is defensive, grows angry, can be insulted, is defensive. It's that wolf nature or that snake nature. And it has to be dealt with to the very bottom. He was not going to take any superficial surrender. The Holy Spirit put his finger on each part of my self life, and I had to decide in cold blood. He could never take a thing away until I gave my consent. Then the moment I gave it, some purging took place. Isaiah 6:5-7. And I could never touch that thing again. It was not saying I was purged and the thing still having a hold on me. No, it was a breaking and the Holy Ghost taking control. I need to stop again. I've known many who have gone through this breaking and purging process, and then after it's completed, they've gone back and grabbed it again. They've repented, and then they've gone back and grabbed it again. After a period of time, when you repent of it, there is no sense of a purging. There's no sense of freedom. The bondage seems very powerful, because we have gone back and rebuilt what the Holy Spirit destroyed by the blood of Jesus. And then what begins to happen is greater conviction will fall upon us, and we know we have to be free of that thing. And yet praying simply does not break that bondage anymore, because we have rebuilt it so many times, our heart has become hardened and calloused. And now God wants to know, do you really want this broken in your heart? Do you really want to be free of this sin? The first time, it was very simple, a simple prayer of confession and repentance. The Holy Spirit, you renounce it, the Holy Spirit comes in, he breaks the power, you're set free. But after returning time after time, the chains grow much heavier and much stronger. And now there has to come a place where we become so desperate before God that we cut off this thing, we renounce it in the name of Jesus, and yet we have no sense of its being broken. And now we have to stand by raw faith and face the enemy and face what we have done. And generally, it will now take a beating to get free of that thing. Because the devil says, you don't really want to be free of that. Look how many times you've come back to me. Well, almost everything that God does in the soul of a man or woman is organic. By that I mean, it grows up in us. I know a man who has gone back time after time after time after time to fornication. And now he's standing by faith that he will not return to his sexual sin of fornication. Now it's a battle. And the scriptures say, you have not yet resisted sin to the point of shedding your blood, but it may come to that kind of struggle in your heart when you have rebuilt time after time things of wickedness, lying, cheating, stealing, fornication, pornography, drugs, alcohol, smoking, gluttony. How many times I've heard a person who is obese say, you know, I want to lose weight. I've been on a diet. I just can't lose. No, you can't. Because you're in a bondage the devil has created because you have said yes and you have spurned the voice of the Holy Spirit so many times. And now you have to face the reality. Whether it's gluttony or gossiping or whatever, homosexuality, whatever the sin is sin. It is rebellion against God. It is denying the voice of the Holy Spirit and going my own way. And so many of you now are facing a tremendous battle. And frankly, you need brothers and sisters in Christ who will walk with you in this battle, who will hold you sharply accountable with love, but sharply, who will question you. I know some people who will not come now to the National Prayer Chapel because they know that as soon as I begin to speak with them one-on-one, I'm going to say, what's happening in your walk with Jesus? And specifically, have you gone back to your sin even once? Or are you still clean before God? I'm going to ask those kinds of questions because I'm investing my time and my energy to pray for that person for release from that bondage. It's costing me time and energy. And so when I'm with them, I'm not going to be polite as in politically correct. I'm going to get right to the heart of the issue. One man that I speak with often, I don't exchange pleasantries with him, because I know that he could stand and exchange pleasantries all day. I instead go right to the heart of it and say, what is the Holy Spirit saying to you today? I want to know. Is the Holy Spirit saying you have scorned me once again? Is the Holy Spirit saying you have the victory today in the blood of Jesus? What is the Holy Spirit saying to you? The Holy Spirit is not silent. It's his job to bring to you Jesus Christ. He is active in that process. If you can't hear him, it's because you have seared your hearing and you have turned aside from the Lord, and conviction no longer quickens in your heart. And it is now going to take some very determined effort on your part to demonstrate to the Holy Spirit that you're serious about this walk with Jesus. And now you're going to have to allow the Holy Spirit to organically grow up in you maturity. You're going to have to allow the Holy Spirit to grow up in you the righteousness that he would quickly give to you before you rejected and turned aside time after time. I'm hearing in my spirit that there is someone, maybe several, listening. You know that I'm speaking to you. You know that you've rejected the Holy Spirit time after time. And now your heart is quickened and he's calling after you, but you're still going back to that sin. And you want to be free. If you're that person, call right now and let me pray with you. You need a brother. You need a sister. You need people who will walk with you. Don't slip back into the old way of life. Don't continually slip back, because one day you will slip through the crack and you will find yourself in hell. My phone number in the studio, if you're one of these people and you need to be prayed for, you need to be encouraged. The telephone number is 877-534-0780. I invite you to call quickly. I'm just hearing that right now we're at a turning point in many of your lives. You know that what I'm speaking is the truth. You know in your heart you want Jesus. You know you've gone back, you've slid down, 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 down. And you know that if you continue in this direction, you'll end up in hell. But there's a part of your heart that's crying out to Jesus. And you want that deliverance. You need desperately that deliverance. Call quickly, 877-534-0780. Don't just pretend everything's okay and you're cool and life is going to go on, because life is not going to go on. You are going to hit the wall, and it will be too late. If you're that person, call quickly. He was not going to take any superficial surrender. He put his finger on each part of my self-life, and I had to decide in cold blood. He could never take a thing away until I gave my consent. Then the moment I gave it, some purging took place, and I could never touch that thing again. It was not saying I was purged and the thing still having a hold on me. No, it was a breaking and the Holy Spirit taking control. Day by day, the dealing went on. He was coming in as God, and I had lived as a man. And what is permissible to an ordinary man, he told me, will no longer be permissible to you. This experience was the crisis which was followed by the process of sanctification, during which the Holy Spirit, on the basis of his initial surrender, step by step replaced the self nature with his own divine nature. 2 Peter, the first chapter, verse 4. First, there was the love of money, that root of evil which had formerly taken Rees to America. The Lord told him that he would take out of his nature all taste for money and any ambition for the ownership of money. I had to consider what that meant, Rees said. Money would be no more to me than it was to John the Baptist or to the Savior. To an extent, this was dealt with in my new birth, but now the Holy Spirit was getting at the root. The dealings on that lasted a whole day, and by the evening, this attitude toward money had entirely changed. Then there was the fact that he would never have the right to a choice in making a home. I saw I could never give my life to another person, to live to that one alone. Could the Savior have given his life and attention to one person instead of to a lost world? Neither could the Holy Spirit. He took plenty of time to show me exactly what it would mean. The life he would live would be for the world. Was I willing for that? Among other things that were dealt with was ambition. How could he have any if the Holy Spirit came in? The way the Lord showed it to him was like this. Supposing he had a mission in a town and another mission opened in the same place. If there was jealousy between the two and it was better for the town only to have one mission, then it would be his which would have to go. Or suppose that he and another man should apply for the same job. He would have to let the other have it. Or if he was earning 12 shillings a day and another man with a family was earning much less, the Spirit could tell him to give his job to that man. He saw the Holy Ghost in ways like that taking the place of the other and suffering instead of him. Yes, he was willing for that. On the fifth day, his reputation was touched. As he was thinking of men of the Bible who were full of the Holy Spirit, particularly John the Baptist, the Lord said to him, "Then I may live through you the kind of life I live through him, a Nazarite clothed in camel's hair living in a desert." Even in this, or what might be its modern equivalent, a real decision had to be made. If I live my life in you, and that is the kind of life I choose, the Holy Spirit said, you cannot stop me. That was the Lord's word on it. As the Savior was despised, he must be willing to be the same. By Friday night, each point had been faced. He knew exactly what he was being offered. The choice between temporal and eternal gain. The Spirit summed the issue up for him by saying, "On no account will I allow you to cherish a single thought of self, and the life I will live in you will be 100% for others. You will never be able to save yourself any more than the Savior could when he was on earth. Now are you willing?" Rees was to give his final answer. That night a friend said to him, "If some of us come over after the meeting, will you tell us of your position in Christ?" At once the Spirit challenged him. "How could you do that? You've seen the position of the overcomers, but you have not entered in. I've been dealing with you for 5 days. You must give me your decision by 6 o'clock tonight, and remember, you must go. On no account will I allow you to bring in a cross current. Where I send you, you will go. What I say to you, you will do." It was the final battle of the will. I asked him for more time, but he said, "You will not have a minute after 6 o'clock. When I heard that, it was exactly as if a wild beast was aroused in me. "You give me free will," I answered, "and now you force me to give it up." "I do not force you," he replied. "But for 3 years, have you not been saying that you are not your own, and that you wanted to give your life back to the Savior as completely as he gave his for you?" I climbed down in a second. The way I had said it was an insult to God. "I'm sorry," I told him. "I didn't mean what I said." "You are not forced to give up your will," he said again. "But at 6 o'clock, I will take your decision. After that, you will never get another chance." It was my last offer, my last chance. I saw that throne, Revelation 3:21, and all my future for eternity going. I said, "Please forgive me. I want to do it." Once more the question came, "Are you willing?" It was 6:10. "I wanted to do it, but I could not." Your mind is keen when you are tested, and in a flash it came to me, "How can self be willing to give up self?" 5:05 came. I was afraid of those last 5 minutes. I could count the ticks of the clock. And then the Spirit spoke again. "If you can't be willing, would you like me to help you? Are you willing to be made willing?" "Take care," the enemy whispered. "When a stronger person than yourself is on the other side, to be willing to be made willing is just the same as to be willing." As I was thinking upon that point, I looked at the clock. It was 6:01. I bowed my head, and I said, "Lord, I am willing." Within an hour, the third person of the Godhead had come in. He gave Rees that word in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse 19. "Having therefore boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, Immediately, said Reese, I was transported into another realm, within the sacred veil where the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost live. There I heard God speaking to me, and I have lived there ever since. When the Holy Spirit enters, he comes in to abide forever. To the blood be the glory. How I adored the grace of God. It is God who goes so far as to give us the gift of repentance. It was God who helped me to give up my will. There were some things he had asked for during the week that I was able to give because I was the master of them. But when he asked me to give up myself and my will, I found I could not until he pulled me through. An eyewitness tells us that no words can describe the little meeting in the house that night. The glory of God came down. Reese started singing the chorus, "There's power in the blood." And they couldn't stop singing for 2 hours. Then from 9 p.m. to 2:30 a.m., it was nothing but the Holy Spirit speaking things I'd never dreamed of and exalting the Savior. When he awoke the next morning, he said, I realized that the Holy Spirit had come in to abide forever. The feeling I had was that he had brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. It is impossible to describe the floods of joy that followed. Reese Howells was not a person who was given to public speaking. He was naturally quiet and retiring. But when the Holy Spirit entered, he loosed his tongue and brought his own boldness in. There was a praise meeting that morning in the covenant tent with about 1,000 people present, including some 200 ministers. The first person Reese saw there was his own minister, and if anything could have stopped him speaking, it was the fact of his presence. But during the meeting, Reese stood up and told them clearly and calmly that he was calling them to be witnesses that the Holy Spirit, who had entered the apostles on the day of Pentecost, had entered him and would produce similar results. The effect was so great that during the next week, when crowds had gathered to hear the messages from a famous speaker, literally hundreds came to ask Reese how the Holy Spirit had entered him. It was the first stream of those promised rivers, which, as Jesus said, flow out of those in whom the Holy Spirit dwells. Is there a cry in your heart for the indwelling power and presence of the Holy Spirit? You cannot have the power of the Holy Spirit and walk in your flesh. If you want the Holy Spirit, you're going to have to move out of your body. You're going to have to allow the Holy Spirit full authority and full power over your life. The demand is that you must give up yourself. This is not an easy process. It's called crucifixion. It's where a man or a woman finally recognizes that they have been controlled by their own self-interest. And now it's time to repent. I'm going to ask our producer if he would play for us that song. I believe it's Hugh Preedy who sings it, Repent.
Confess that though your love is in me, competing with my sin. And I repent, making no excuses. I repent, no one else to blame, and I return to fall in love with Jesus. I bow down on my knees, and I I've accepted the commandments I've rejected to pursue my selfish end. And I confess I need you to revive me, put selfishness behind me, and take up my cross again. And I repent, making no excuses. I repent, no one else to blame. And I bow down on my knees, and I return to fall in love with Jesus. I bow.
When the divine owner takes possession of a property, he has a twofold objective. One, intense cultivation, and two, abounding fruitfulness. But if the land is fallow ground, he can only till it acre by acre. We shall see the owner now at work in his newly claimed estate. The first act he put under fresh cultivation is Rees Howell's in his prayer life. Rees had been used to praying general prayers, but if someone had asked him if he knew he was going to get an answer to prayer, he would not have known what to say. Now the Holy Spirit told him the meaning of prayer is answer. And of all that I give you, see that you lose nothing. He also told him that effectual praying must be guided praying, and that he was no longer to pray for all kinds of things at his own whim or fancy, but only the prayers that the Holy Ghost gave him to pray. Coupled with this was another important lesson that he was never again to ask God to answer a prayer through others if he could answer it through him. That included his money. When there was a prayer for money, he must allow his own to be used. The Holy Spirit showed him that in the unsurrendered state, he could spend time in asking God to supply the foreign fields and other causes, and yet not be willing for God to answer the prayer through him, and that often the Lord is wearied with our words. All this unreality was to be put on one side, and the scriptures obeyed in the most practical sense. The first prayer of this kind that the Holy Spirit prayed through him was for a young man named Will Battery. He had come to the district some years before to live with his uncle after having had meningitis, which had left him in a very weak condition. In this state, liquor had gotten a hold on him, and he had gone from bad to worse. He hadn't slept in a bed for 2 years, but spent his night in the boiler room of the tin mill. He was dirty, unshaven. He wore no socks and never tied his own shoelaces. The revival had been in the district and hundreds had been converted, but no one had reached Will Battery. It was for this man that Mr. Howells, to his own surprise, found the Holy Ghost travailing in him. Reese was to pray him through to sanity and salvation and love him not in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. "It wouldn't have come to my mind to love him," he said, "but when the Holy Spirit comes in, he brings in the love of the Savior. It seemed as if I could lay down my life for this man. There was a love pouring out of me that I had never known before. Naturally speaking, he would be the last one with whom I would spend my spare time, and the tin mill would be the last place." In his free hours, Reese made this man his friend and spent all of his Sundays with him. He had more joy, he said, seeking to win this one than at chapel in the company of the other believers. He even walked about the village with him, although embarrassed once or twice as people turned and stared at them. But, he said, "the Lord pulled me up on it," and he rejoiced. About 10 days before Christmas, the Spirit asked Reese what gift he would like, as this was the first Christmas since he had come into his life. The choice Reese made was obvious, that Will Battery should have a blessing. But from that day on, Battery disappeared. "I sought him for 10 evenings, Reese said, "as a mother looks for her child. I didn't yet know the ways of the Holy Ghost, and he wanted me to trust him." Then the day before Christmas, Battery came to look for him. "I can hear his footsteps now," says Reese, reminiscing, "and oh, the sensation of it. I hadn't the faintest idea of the love of the Holy Spirit for a lost soul until he loved one through me. And what an evening we had together. The next day I had the joy of spending my first Christmas after the Holy Ghost had come in the tin mill with this young man from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. My mother gave me a basket with Christmas dinner for the two of us, but my joy was too great to eat. Battery had the lot. At 4 p.m., he asked if he could come with me to the cottage meeting. What joy I had in walking with him there. I had never asked him to go myself for fear of embarrassing him. But the work was not done in a few weeks or months. Stage by stage, Will was lifted until Reese was able to put him in a lodging and get him to take a job in the mine. Even then, there were lapses, such as when Reese was summoned to face an angry landlord. Will Battery had gone to bed with his pit clothes on, boots included. Reese hastily told her to send the sheets to the laundry at his expense. The day came when the chapel people were amazed to see Battery sitting in the meeting, respectably dressed, but it took 3 years for the final victory When at last Mr. Howes was able to persuade him to go home to his mother, who was a converted woman and had prayed for him for years. "In this way," said Mr. Howes, "I started at the bottom and loved just one. And if you love one, you can love many. And if many, you can love all." The second outstanding prayer the Holy Spirit prayed through him was for a man who was by the name of Jim Stakes, his real name being James Thomas. It was also the means by which the Holy Spirit gave Rees Howes his first lesson in princely giving. As he said later, "Since my money now belongs to the new tenant, the old tenant has to be impartial about the amount he gives. The new tenant, by his nature, is more generous than the old one. The latter has lived so long in Egypt and later in the wilderness under the law that he had only been used at best to giving the tithes. So when the new tenant wants to give a princely gift, he first tests the reality of the surrender. If it is proved genuine, then there will be no future conflicts when large amounts are called for." The test for Rees was on Jim Stakes. This man had been such a low character that the common saying was, "What Jim Stakes would do, the devil himself could not do." He was one of the worst drunkards, and there was a great sensation during the revival when he went under conviction and came out for salvation in a prayer meeting. He had a house full of children, and through his old drinking habit, he was in great poverty. Rees Howes had only met him once, but knew him well by reputation. One morning, when in prayer, quite unexpectedly, this man stood before him. "I had never before known such a conflict for a soul in the spirit realm," Rees says. "For an hour, it was as much as I could do to allow the Holy Ghost to pray through me. I saw the devil attacking him, and that if he could, he would get him back. And it would be one of the best things the devil could do to counteract the work of the revival. I saw that it was a conflict between God and the devil for a soul, and I told the Lord I would do anything if he would keep Jim Stakes." That very evening, there was a man at the door to see me. Rees never had a greater surprise. It was Jim Stakes. He had come a distance of 2 miles because he said that while he was working in the mine that morning at 10 o'clock, Rees Howes stood before him. It was at that very hour in the morning that Jim Stakes had stood before Rees, and the burden of prayer had come upon him. "Are you in trouble?" Rees asked. He was indeed. He was 2 years behind in his rent, and that morning the bailiffs had marked his furniture and were coming to take it. 2 years' rent? It was a lot of money. After a moment of hesitation, Mr. Howes said, "I'll give you 1 year's rent, and I have a friend who I believe will give the other half." He went upstairs to get the money. But before he reached the top of the stairs, the Holy Spirit spoke to him. "Didn't you tell me this morning that you would give all you had to save him? Why are you only giving him half? Did not the Savior pay all your debt and set you free?" Rees Howes turned and ran down the stairs and said to the man, "I'm sorry I told you I would only give you 1 year's rent. I am to give you 2 years' rent and all you need beside. I am to deliver you in such a way that the devil can't use this situation any longer to get at you." The moment I said that, Mr. Howes declared later, the joy of heaven came down. It was as if something snapped in my nature, and it became more blessed to give than to receive. The amount of the gift was 70 pounds. Mr. Howes took him straight over that evening to see a friend and have prayer together, and on the way he asked him if his wife was converted. Hadn't she seen a change in him, and wasn't she glad? "Yes," Jim replied, "but she is not saved, and she hasn't had the clothes to go to meeting." As he listened, Mr. Rees Howes said he felt the Spirit as though virtue had gone out to her, and he knew that she too would be converted. The following Sunday, he went to their house and found her under conviction. The princely gift had broken her down. Love had conquered. And the Holy Spirit led her to the foot of the cross, where she saw that a still greater debt had to be paid for her, and paid with a greater price, the precious blood of Jesus Christ. The blessing of this couple was that Reese called the beginning of days in the district, because cottage meetings were started in their home every Saturday and Sunday evening, led by Reese Howells and his friends. Many came to them. Some of the worst characters gave their hearts to the Lord. In this new experience of life in the Holy Ghost, Reese had one whose fellowship meant much to him, his Uncle Dick. When Reese returned from Landendod, not all believers by any means could see the need of this total surrender to the Holy Spirit. Some even opposed the idea, but God gave him one of like mind and heart in his uncle. Of all the believers in the district, he might have been thought that Uncle Dick had the least need for this full surrender. For 26 years he'd been an invalid, not able to walk more than a few yards, nor to read to himself more than a few minutes at a time. He had accepted this condition as the will of God and spent hours daily in prayer or of having the Bible read to him by members of the family. Before the revival, when the spiritual state in the country had been so low, he had joined with many in praying for a quickening and had greatly rejoiced when the answer came. Yet he also knew his own need. Before the revival, even among the most godly in the church, few had known of eternal life as a free gift or of the assurance of the forgiveness of sins. Even after the revival, the truth of the Holy Spirit as a divine person living in the believer's body was hidden from most, including Uncle Dick. He had a longing for more power and prayer, but he'd never known how to get it. Uncle Dick rejoiced in Reese's conversion, and it was to him that Reese continued to look up to as his most valued spiritual guide. That's it for today. I pray the Holy Spirit has touched your heart. I'll talk to you soon. God bless you.
Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory.